Czech Pavilion of the last Venice Biennale. Because before I introduce briefly our guests, I have to say that actually we are currently within the reconstructed space of the Czech and Slovak Pavilion of the Venice Biennale, the project of Jiří David called Apotheosis. This exhibition will be inaugurated in 2 days during the grand opening on Friday, February 5th, to which you are very cordially invited. But before, we are going to open an exhibition called Generosity, the Art of Giving, which celebrates the National Gallery's 220th anniversary. And here you are to witness the very pre-opening of this project, because those two gentlemen are going to introduce us to, I hope, the concept of generosity, which is the main issue we discuss, we are concerned by, and we take into account while celebrating this very important moment in the history of this institution. The exhibition Generosity, the Art of Giving, is a monumental project which embraces all venues of the National Gallery and our collections. The main exhibition is located in the Kinsky Palace on the second floor, and then there are artistic interventions that are taking place in all venues of the National Gallery, from Stenberg through Schwarzenberg, Sun Palace, Poletechniki, of course, and Kinsky and St. Agnes Convent. I would like to welcome artists present in this room who contributed beautifully to those interventions. For the exhibition, we prepared a book. The book mysteriously called White Rabbit. It is a companion to this project. It is a narration of the history of the gallery, but also it is an attempt to define what generosity is. So the aim of the project of Generosity, the Art of Giving, is to say that the history of museums is parallel to the history of generosity. And those two wonderful men who are sitting on my right-hand side beautifully contributed with their words, with their thoughts to White Rabbit. Markus Steinweg wrote a fascinating essay on generosity, where he is introducing a contemporary subject as a tropical vagabond. And Andrei Vasha wrote about friendship, talking about Ulysses' voyage and about Kurtz's journey. And he investigates the frontiers of the friendship itself. Tonight, Markus Steinweg, the main speaker, is going to talk about generosity, but also about excess, subjectivity, waste, and contingency. Markus Steinweg is a master of subject politics. He's currently a professor of philosophy at the Brunswick University. He has collaborated and is collaborating with many important artists. And first of all, Thomas Hirschhorn and Rosemary Trockel. He wrote many interesting books. One of them is just here on this table, Holding the Liebe. Please go to our bookstore to purchase it. He also wrote the book Politics of Subject. He wrote the book about Margaret Duras together with Rosemary Trockel. He investigates the relationship between art and philosophy, writing about the friendship between art and philosophy. And I again repeat his ongoing collaboration with Thomas Hirschhorn, most recently during Grandier's Gramsci monument in New York. Markus, for 3 months, delivered one lecture a day within the artwork of Thomas Hirschhorn. This is extremely important aspect of Markus's research. Markus is also editor-in-chief of the magazine In Aesthetics. Andrzej Vasa, you may know him from Prague, currently residing in Florence, doing very important research. He graduated from the Philosophy of Humanity, for the Faculty of Humanities and Faculty of Arts at Charles University, and currently he's doing PhD at the Faculty of Philosophy, as far as I know. He wrote many important essays. He is going to respond to Marcus's talk and then conduct a dialogue with Marcus and hopefully a polylogue with you tonight. So again, welcome Marcus Steinbeck, Andrzej Vasa, welcome all of you, and once again, please come to the Waletschny on Friday from 7 o'clock on. There will be a performance of Prinz Golem, there will be a performance of Heinrich Dunst, there will be a work of Mats Leiderstam, and many, many others. Please join us and enjoy the evening.
So, do you get the songs? Yeah. Thanks very much for this generous invitation. The topic not only of this this exhibition that I couldn't saw until now because I just arrived yesterday evening, and but I will I hopefully can see it later. The topic of generosity will be the topic of my talk tonight. I will not speak very long, so maybe like something like 40 minutes, 45, and I asked Adam to give me a sign, or please, you all are invited to tell me it's too long, stop. We have to talk, or first, of course, it's Andre who will give his proper speech and response. So thanks to you also accepting talking with me. This is so double generosity. Generosity of the institution represented by Adam and the team, of course, and of Andrzej talking with me. Like always, I'm not prepared. Like always, I have no paper in my hands. That does not mean that I'm totally fucked up. It simply means this is a normality of all of us, like in different situations. You do not have to be a philosopher or making a kind of, let's say, public speech. But in everyday life, all of us, we found all of us, every one of us found itself in the situation of a kind of lack of orientation. So not knowing where to go, not knowing what to say, not knowing what is right. And decided today, of course, by referring the general topic of generosity, to speak about my concept of philosophy. What is philosophy? What does it mean to make philosophy from my point of view, of course, and afterwards we can, of course, discuss it. Because I appreciated very much this idea to talk about the concept of not only of generosity, but also of excess and a kind of hyperbolism. That means hyperbole is the old Greek word for exaggeration. That means doing more or even doing less, so you can exaggerate in both directions. And so not doing the right thing, in a way, would be being hyperbolic in what you do, what you say. And as far as I got tonight, so there are some writers here, there are artists here, some visual artists, like we call it, and we like to make the differentiation between art, philosophy, writing, dancing, choreography, science, and so on. And in fact, as I know that Andre later will talk about the concept of friendship, I want to say something about friendship, and because friendship demands a kind of generosity, because because the one I'm the friend of does not necessarily has to accept me like I am, but he does. He wouldn't be my friend if he wouldn't do so, and vice versa. So maybe close to love, you do not know who you're loving, who the other is, and the other remains quite strange and different from you, from yourself. And but nevertheless, you say yes. This is a gesture of hyperbolic, of non-reasonable, exaggerated hospitality. Of course, I'm referring here now on a French philosopher, contemporary philosopher, even if he died 10 years ago, 12 years ago, 13 years ago, he died in 2004, Jacques Derrida. Jacques Derrida is the philosopher of unconditional hospitality. So this is a very beautiful concept, and we have, it comes in my mind, of course, now because there are so many crises around, right? And so there was, I'm speaking here a bit from a naive and a bit stiff German point of view, and terribly German, but I'm traveling, and that gives me the opportunity to see that there's more than one perspective already in Germany, but also in Europe and beyond of Europe concerning all these crises. So refugee crisis, the crisis connected to Greece, financial crisis of this country and so on. So what's called a crisis. And then at the same time we know that as a philosopher, of course, I have to deal with that constantly, that philosophy, the concept of philosophy is already a Greek concept, an old Greek concept, and it has to do with philia, with friendship. But the idea of, I wrote a book on love that has to deal, of course, with the concept of unconditional love, because this is our romantic concept of love. You love someone without reasons. Is it true? No, of course not. But you have 1,000 reasons, but the one reason is lacking, you know, and this is why I'm still romantic. I have many, many reasons to love someone, and humor, beauty, whatever, intelligence, help to love someone, but this can never be the reason, because the final reason, the one argument is lacking, so it's not about having a good argument in love. And do you remember this film of Jean-Luc Godard? I always forget which one it was, Le Mépris or Jean Sébert and Belmondo in the bed. Which film is it? A Bout de Souffle. Okay. And then there's this scene, she asking him, why do you love me? Do you like my nose? Do you like my hair? So something like this. So I'm not here very well in remembering, it's a bit like this. Do you like my hair? Do you like my my legs? Do you like my look? Do you like whatever? Of course you would. It would be so easy to say, yes, I love this. So constant affirmation of all these qualities of a person, but this is not generous, to love someone because of what this guy, this person, this male, female, it doesn't matter, is. So love is not about loving someone for what she is. But then, of course, we immediately jump into a kind of hyperbolic generosity that has to do with loving someone for what she is not doing. And that can be kind of problematic in everyday life, because then there's so much misunderstandings between the people. The one is in this imaginary and following its image of the other, he or she produced of the other. We all know this, and at the same time, yeah, the other is not fitting this image, not fulfilling my imaginary, and vice versa again. So love is a complicated thing, I would say, and this is why it demands generosity. I love you, to tell someone I love you simply means I love you nevertheless. I don't know who you are, I do not really get what you think. I promise to understand what you mean by saying what you say, but I take the risk to say I love you, and that means also to say it in the most stereotyped way, because this exists in all, I do not speak Czech, but in German it's ich liebe dich, en français c'est je t'aime, in English it's I love you, and these are the three languages, a part of old Greek and Latin I speak, or I know a bit, and how do you say in Italian? Ti amo. Ti amo, yeah. And so it sounds as nice, as kitschy, as terrible, as beautiful. So, and this is the trap, I would say, in concerning the love question. So I just came to this topic of love because I think especially love and philosophy has to do with the old Greek word philein means to be the lover of or to be the friend of. The word phileo, philein, Philos is the friend of, and of Sophia, of wisdom. This is a classical translation of them. I do not like the word wisdom. It sounds too old-fashioned and not really on the height of the topics to think nowadays. So my proposal would be to translate some philosophy or the old Greek term philosophia, not in the sense of love or wisdom, but the love for the truth of reality. For the truth of reality, what does it mean? It simply means for the very inconsistency of what we call reality. Reality is simply our reality as human beings, each one of us, but it means also reality in the sense of the world or what we are used to call or to name simply the world reality, so something consistent. And I do not believe in consistency. I think there are a lot of consistencies around, and they constitute what we simply call reality. So here's a table, and there's a microphone on the table. I took my way, and there's some glasses, some books, and so on, and the table is consistent enough, stable enough, just not to break, it's consistent, this material, kind of wood and plastic and mixed of constitutes this table and constitutes a kind of consistency of this material and this table, reality in general, in a more general way, is not as consistent as supposed. And this is what I would like to talk about, and I will connect it to the topic of generosity. So because thinking, philosophical thinking, is for me at least, and this is nothing but a proposal, we can talk about this later together. Thinking has to do with an act and the dynamics of generosity. What does it mean to be generous? To be generous means to give more than you have. So if you are a smoker and you need cigarettes, maybe there's here, yesterday evening I arrived here in Prague and I went to an Italian place here in the neighborhood to eat something, and I was pleased. I'm a non-regular smoker. I didn't smoke yesterday, but I was so pleased that people are allowed to smoke, and I think this is an act of generosity to let people live like they want, even if it's not good for their health. And things are going problematic, and at the moment I would say because nowadays the state or the European state tells you how you have to live. I do not agree with that. Okay, this is just a side remark. I believe in freedom as an index or what indicates freedom is the right to do wrong things. You know, not everything, but in a way, wrong things concerning yourself. And if the state is intervening in your self-relation, it's problematic. Okay, if you're a smoker. And cigarettes, I don't know, here, and let's say it's €5 and a box, and then you buy cigarettes and you have €5 and you put them into the machine and you get cigarettes back in, let's say 20 cigarettes and a box, the worth of €5. So this exchange simply indicates that economically nothing happened. So because on both sides of the sign of, how do you say, equivalence, nothing, there's the same worth. And this is the very sense of the sign. So these two, how do you say, signs, so these two, sorry, yeah. Yeah, equal sign. Okay, thanks. And so it's about equality. The problem is that generosity is breaking up with equality, but the question would be in a way how being, so in a political perspective, is it possible to first to accept that equality is nothing but a kind of phantasm? So equality is nothing, but even so, capitalism, Karl Marx is a theorist of capitalism, Engels, and so on. Later, other people, they didn't believe with good reasons in the very logic of equality and equivalency. So because there's never the same value on. Both sides, there's a kind of disbalance, or how do you say, and there's a kind of structural injustice to deal with, and the question, the topic of generosity, has also to do with that. So generosity is more or less normally. Judged as something positive. To be generous is at least not being, how do you say, stinky, avare en français, or geizig in German. And I like people that are not avare, and we do not have the time now, but the whole psychoanalysis, of course, and Freud is dealing with this topic of anal, sorry to tell you what you maybe already know, and the anal retention. So even you are even not ready to give your shit by shitting, as for example a narcissistic personality, you're not ready. So to give anything, because the simple fact that you exist is already a gift. You gave so much simply by existing, by being born, without ever having decided being born, that these parents in this cultural frame and so on. And so we cannot talk about this now because we do not have the time. Just make this as a side remark. We cannot talk about generosity without talking about narcissism. And narcissism is precisely non-generosity, not being ready to give anything. We're not talking about money necessarily. We're talking about humor. We're talking about time. We're talking about energy. So, if and we all have these people around us, and maybe we belong to this group of people. Let's find it out once. But everyone at least Even if we do not belong to this group of people, every one of us has people around him or herself, like not being ready to give time, energy, money, always having no money with themselves. So, okay, sorry, sounds super vulgar and super simple what I'm talking about now, but I'm talking about the simple fact that to be generous means to make a step beyond, out of this ordinary, everyday narcissism most of us know, and or by ourselves or by looking, by experience, making the experience with, concerning this with our friends. So like we cannot talk about generosity without talking about narcissism. And narcissism, what does it mean? Narcissism is not vanity. So vanity, how do you say? Vanity, Eitelkeit in German, is, I would say simply that, I put it, of course, a bit simple, but like someone, like in a fairy tale, like looking into the mirror and being happy with what you see. And the mirror is not necessarily a mirror. It can be simply other people, society, the boyfriend, the girlfriend, the best friends, or an audience, you know, after you met it for and telling you it was great what you did, blah, blah. So terrible. So you're immediately in the trap of like believing the people that tell you they just want to be nice, and they tell you they nourish your vanity by making you finally believe that they really believe in what they said, and maybe it's not the case. And so vanity is a kind of male problem, I would say. I'm simplifying very much. And normally we have the idea, it's in the fairy tales, a woman, the princess, or the, I don't know, someone looking into the mirror and really liking what she gets back as feedback from the mirror. But I think this is not true. I think it's a male problem. Because this is in our patriarchal systems and cultural systems since a long time, many hundred years, centuries. The men have the problem really to believe in what they think, what they get back, and the feedback that they get back. So they are in this kind of trap of like believing in a kind of like consistency that is constituted by the feedback they get, and I would say very simplified that their problem is precisely here, like believing in what people tell them, you're successful, you're great, you do a good job, and so on, and of course this is a trap. There's another trap, and this is what we can call the imaginary and the more narcissistic thing. Narcissism, like I said, I started to say, and vanity is not the same. And what's the difference? Narcissism precisely has to do with the gap, the difference between what I think I finally am. So my deeper truth, that of course is a kind of imaginary construction. So maybe my parents told me you are a little prince, or they told you you are a little princess, and okay, what you want to do in the age of 3, 4, 5, in a way, you are the victim of the narcissism of your parents. And they tell you, okay, you are this and this and this, you are so over, you have so much talent, and you are a little genius, and blah, blah. I think it's not a good idea to tell your kids in this age things like that. Because afterwards they need many decades and at least one therapy to get through to get beyond, for at least a step beyond maybe not the final step, but a certain step out of this kind of narcissism that is a result of the narcissism of the parents, telling them, okay, you're so great, you have so much talent, and you are much more interesting than most other kids and people and so on. And of course, we can imagine the situation, the kid then like goes to school at the age of, I don't know, 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, in my time, I think it was 6 years, and then and being in contact with other kids and so many princesses and so many princes, and so there might be a real conflict. So who finally is the prince, and who is the one that how do you say, deserves this role? Nobody, of course. And so I simply want to say that all this is a kind of narcissistic economy. It has to do with lack of reflection of the parents. It has to do with factual victims that are the kids. They are put into the situation of being this kind of little princess and prince, and that puts them into a kind of anal economy. So then they need a long time to get out of this, if it is possible, and they live a huge part of their life as anal, narcissistic, stinky subjects that are not ready to give anything but their pure existence, and that's enough. And I think it's not a good idea. And so what is generosity? Generosity means simply to start thinking and to interrogate, to quest, to the questionnaire, how we say, my English is very poor, I'm sorry, but to interrogate, to analyze this narcissistic economy. That means also to analyze the very idea of equivalence, equivalence. Yeah, so there's no reason, and that does not mean that I'm here pro-capitalist. Of course, I hope you understand that it's not. I really like this in Karl Marx, and I like it in Gilles Deleuze, a French philosopher. Simply being fascinated by the very logic of capitalism. And capitalism is not some has nothing to do with stabilizing the system, or I don't know. It has very much to do with what Deleuze called deterritorialisation. So that means with excess. And excess, the word of excess was in the title of my announced talk, or it's more some remarks, like you see tonight. And so my question is, and later we'll start a discussion, and maybe, and but so how can we deal with the simple fact that our that capitalism nowadays, late capitalism, let's say capitalism in its state of like nowadays it's capitalism. I'm not telling you something true, something new, but nowadays, since 15 years, we know about the new spirit of capitalism. So, Luc Botanski and so on. And, so the idea that capitalism nowadays tells you, be creative, do something, move, stop sleeping, stop with like tranquilizing yourself in stereotypes, ideologies, doxae, all Greek, opinions, count opinions. So think. So capitalism nowadays tells you, think against capitalism, be against mice. against me. And so, but of course, the capitalism is a kind of personalized demon monster. It does not exist. It's always a kind of construction. But the very functioning logic of capitalism nowadays is, of course, that it appropriated all the methods and the dynamics and strategies of resistance against it. So nowadays, so capitalism is now something totally different than, let's say, in the 70s or 80s. So remember the time, I don't know, but at least we know that from TV and recordings, but Woodstock and the idea of dancing against the capitalism. And now the capitalism tells you, dance against me, you know. And so capitalism is now in a new state, and so it changed totally. And capitalism is actual capitalism is anti-capitalist. And this is a bit the trap in which we are. So how to not speak too long, and the question, not to lose the topic of the exhibition, generosity and expenditure, and going beyond excess, doing more than you can do. So, and so there was a time in which many of my friends are artists, and there are many of them are much older than me, so that means 20 years older, 17 years older. So, they taught me a lot, and I understood that, and I know them also since a long time, most of them, or many of them, and then I understood, of course, in the 90s, the very idea of artistic production was totally different than nowadays. So there was a very ideological idea of art has to do with intensity, with excess, with let's say anti. I say it also because I'm half French and living in Paris and then Berlin, so I have this opportunity to compare with the societies and the art scenes and. Yeah, there's very much the idea that in France and Paris to be contre la bourgeoisie, anti-bourgeois, so whatever that means. So I spent a lot of time in Paris, and what I finally found out in 1789 did not took place. So the French Revolution, when you're in Paris, the very city center of Paris, so you really have the feeling it's still such a conservative society, such a still very bourgeois society, but at the same time it generates a lot of intellectual theorists and people, philosophers. Philosophy has a huge, let's say, recognition in French society since a long time, and much, much more than in Germany, for example. I don't know how it is here in Prague. There is the idea, okay, the intellectuals, and of course Jean-Paul Sartre is the one people are thinking about. The intellectual is someone who resists against bourgeoisie, against established order, against the state, against against established power, and so on. And this is, of course, like you know, this idea of the intellectual is someone engagé, who's engaged against. And this is, of course, something to question nowadays more and more, because this engagement nowadays became a total narcissistic attitude. And so I'm actually, organizing a symposium on the question, what is critique? Qu'est-ce que la critique? Was ist Kritik in Berlin? And I do that with Neuer Bildner Kunstverein, Marius Bavias, and we started this symposium some days ago with Jean-Luc Nancy, the French philosopher, in a huge theater in Berlin, and we will continue the 6th and the 7th February in some days at Neubildner Kunstverein with socialists like Elena Esposito or Eva Illus, and Thomas Sjöström will be there and, as an artist, and Anne Cotton as a writer, and so on, other people. And the very idea of this, this again a side remark, if you allow me to do that, is simply that why is it important to make a symposium with such a title? What is critique? Because we are not critical anymore. We are so much like paralyzed in something that I would like to call a critical attitude. I do not if, you know, it's translatable, dear friends, but critical attitude, that means simply to put a kind of button on your t-shirt, like, I'm so fucking critical, you know? And I live in Berlin since 15 years, 16 years, and I think it's terrible. It's terrible how it works, and not only in Berlin, but in the art, contemporary art theory, art and art theory scene in general. It works so well, like, just to pretend to be critical. I'm critical because I'm against capitalism. Fuck. First read Marx and understand that Marx admired capitalism. And so I would simply say, it's not so easy. You have to pay. Don't jump into this kind of narcissistic economy, of the stinky economy I spoke about, I started to speak about, just not being ready to pay. If you are against so-called actual capitalism, and there are 100,000 reasons to be against, and I'm with all these guys not accepting capitalism nowadays, but it makes part of our reality. And do not jump out of this in this kind of narcissistic, stinky gesture of feeling, being, I don't know, the one who do not belong to this corrupted or problematic ideology and system. We all belong to that, and we're all in the world. Innocence is not an option for nobody. Innocence. So here I'm referring on Bertolt Brecht, on Heiner Müller. I just, it's not because I want to make something like, how do you call it, name dropping. It's not name dropping. I'm not telling you I read some books. It's not about this. Simply telling you, because we do not have the time, Bertolt Brecht and Heiner Müller and Alexander Kluge, other people, Marguerite Duras, like Adam mentioned, I made a book with Rosemarie Trockel on Marguerite Duras, a French writer and filmmaker. These people are very different. What they share is cold view on reality. Reality, that means our world, and we belong to that world. Fucking world. Okay, why not? This world, this reality, is like it is, but it is not necessarily like it is. It simply is like it is. So I think we need both. Kind of clear, cold view. I would also mention Niklas Luhmann, the German sociologist, a great figure of the sociology of the 20th century. Cold view, French structuralism, Foucault, and so on. Let's have the courage to look in a non-moralistic way, in a cold, with a cold view on our realities. And then, this is only one thing. That's not enough. The other thing is then to make some conclusions. But I think we need both. And okay, I stop here because I spoke too long already. I know. And thanks for your generosity, Adam, and for yours too. I stop here. But just with a last remark, and this is something very, for me at least, very beautiful, and this is my proposal to you, to continue reading. Maybe you start already reading Heiner Müller and so on. But Heiner Müller once said, yeah, if, like, Also es ist in German first, sorry, vom Mond aus gesehen sieht alles anders aus. Also, so if you look from the moon, if you take the risk to have a look from the moon on our realities, everything looks different. Also let's don't forget this, okay? Yeah, and we continue.
Okay, so we all seem to be set, is that right? Before the response itself, I have to say thank you, Adam, very much for inviting me. The invitation has already proved itself to be much inspirational, so thanks for the generosity, and also thank you, Marcus, for accepting my response, so as a generous gesture. Right. What is technically brilliant is that my response, which I prepared based on the text by Marcus and qualified guess what the speech will be about, is about the moon. So somehow it just already fit together. Well, now I switch to the Czech language. So, dobrý večer. Oh, damn it. Dobrý večer. A dnešní role je ryze dodatečná, protože, jak už bylo avizováno, mým úkolem je na přednesenou přednášku odpovědět. Ostatně se u jednoho pódia nečekaně a poprvé setkáváme jako lidé, kteří sice mluví o něčem jiném, jinak a dokonce se dívají i jiným směrem, nicméně které spolu od sebe dělí a spojuje jedno působivé slovo, ke kterému dospíváme na konci svých příspěvků do sborníku Národní galerie Bílý králík. Slovo, jehož samotné vyslovení jakoby zavánilo nervozitou a přivolávalo neštěstí. A tím je poetický pojem ztroskotání, či alespoň jeho riziko. Riziko do té míry, jakou je selhání nebo ztroskotání každé cesty. Na Markusovu přednášku každopádně odpovím nejlépe tím... Na Markusovu přednášku. Nicméně odpovím nejlépe tím, že jí budu protiřečit. Because I do believe in consistency. I'm a believer. Nikoli ve smyslu nějaké přímé konfrontace nebo otázek, nýbrž ve smyslu protiváhy jednoho jediného konkrétního příkladu, kterým právě bude měsíc. Čili otevřete se ve smíru. Ostatně Markus v textu, ale i v té přednesené přednášce, ať už přímo nebo nepřímo, vrací k motivům cesty, hledání, chybění nebo naplnění, ale též k elánu, neklidu nebo nedostatku, který nás žene kupředu. Přinejmenším z místa na místo. Já sám si uveřejněné eseji, pokud si v dané monografii přečtete, budu velmi rád, kladl otázku, jak daleko můžeme zajít na našich cestách, co by zvědavci, cestovatelé, astronauté, aniž by se zpřetrhala pouta přátelství, které je jednou z nejsilnějších vazeb sdíleného světa. Neboť přítel je především někým, ke komu se mohu navracet, kdežto dědicové Dantova Odysea, specifického Dantova Odysea, námořníci a objevitelé, mířící za hranice známého světa, poznaného světa, se odebírají na cesty, odkud není návratu. A tak byla-li a je-li řeč o cestách a neklidu, pokusím se Markusově přednášce protiřečit příkladem jedné z takových cest. Lépe řečeno příkladem jejího přízračného, stejně jako faktického cíle. Řeč bude o cestě ke hvězdám, co by k nebeským ostrovům. Pochopitelně jsem si vědom, že nejsme na hvězdárně, či v planetáriu, ale v galerii. Nicméně hovořit o astronomii a o hvězdách může být pro umění přinejmenším poučné. Ostatně není to tak dávno, sotva pár set let, co umění a astronomie sdíleli stejný a vzájemně provázaný nárok na porozumění světu, což umění chránilo před jistou prostoduchostí a astronomii dodávalo vášeň představivosti. Hovořit o cestách a hvězdách tak umožňuje pochopit rezidua astronomie v umění, které v něm dodnes přežívají. Stejně jako pochopit astronomii vyžaduje nezapomenout na obrazy. Ostatně hledět na hvězdy a hledět na obrazy je zvláště v našich časech velmi, velmi podobné. Ale abych byl konkrétní, je příznačné, že jedny z nejbystřejších očí renesanční astronomie před vynálezem dalekohledu, oči Tycha de Brahe, nebo Tycha Braheho, hleděli k obloze z ostrova. Konkrétně pak z observatoře pojmenované jako Diově dceři a muze astronomie, observatoř se jmenoval Uraniborg, nacházející se na malém ostrově Hven, či Ven mezi Dánskem a Švédskem. To nechme teď stranou, do jaké míry byl pro renesanční astronomii pohled na noční oblohu filozofickou a zároveň poetickou kontemplací samotného stvoření. Pouze mi dovolte čistě pro forma připomenout dva související a pro nás podstatné momenty takového hloubavého pohledu. Jak nejlépe právě ukazuje Dantova Božská komedie, pohled do dálavy nebes byl až do kopernikánských časů ve skutečnosti technicky pohledem do nitra stvořeného univerza, do nitra, kterým je okamžik samotného stvoření. Okamžik, který se ocitá mimo náš prostoročas. Přičemž podobnost historii velkého třesku, čiže náhodná paralela je vyloženě okouzlující. Danteho vzestup k ráji je vlastně sestupem k podstatě vesmíru a pohled na takto chápané hvězdné nebe tak byl skutečně chápán v novoplatonském kontextu jako pohled na obraz. Vzdáleně, leč fakticky příbuzný s obrazy religiózní. Kontemplace pravidelného pohybu nebes, planet a stálic, zde se dostáváme k tomu druhému slibovanému momentu, však v sobě nesla též étos nahlíženého řádu. A byla tedy kontemplací etickou, jak kromě jiných opakuje Cicero, o kterém ještě bude dnes řeč. V neposlední řadě pak hvězdáři hleděli k nebeské klenbě či šíři ve sdílené perspektivě s umění. Galileo tak rozezná měsíční povrch očima kreslíře. Bruno bude umění považovat za nedělitelnou metodickou součást reflexe vesmíru. Kepler věnuje většinu svého zralého spisu o harmoniích světa, Harmonices Mundi, analýze hudby a o architektuře vesmíru bude hovořit v intencích spektáklu. Nicméně celá renesanční astronomie, zvláště pak novoplatonsky artikulovaná, sdílí s uměním podobné nástroje chápání univerza. Ostatní vesmír je především stvořený. Ale to zatím ponechme stranou. Tychová astronomie je ve srovnání s řečením dosti věcná. Nicméně i Tycho pozoruje noční oblohu z ostrova, který, cituji, je vhodnější už proto, že je osamělým místem. A kde je, opět cituji, je možné užívat filozofického poklidu. Tycho též nepomine zdůraznit, že samo o sobě dosti promyšlená observatoř stojí na, opět cituji, nejvyšším samo o sobě prominentním místě ostrova, prakticky v jeho středu, kde jsem vybudoval zámek, pojmenovaný po samotných nebesích, tedy Uraniborg. Sám ostrov je tak místem, opět cituji, obklopeným mlhami a přes svoji blízkost pevnině je plovoucí baštou samoty, nehybným středem, z něhož astronom pozoruje hybná nebesa. Ta filozofická samota ostrova se však zdaleka nepromítá jenom do Tychova nesmírně půvabného vesmíru. Jehož je Země a astronomova osamělá observatoř středem. Ponechme stranou půvabnou, ale skutečně nesouvisející Koperníkovu zmínku o, cituji, velmi vzdáleném koutu Země, tedy Fromborku, kde žil a psal revoluční spis De Revolutionibus. I Brunův nekonečný vesmír v sobě totiž nese částečně podobnou osamělost tuláka po hvězdách. Opravdu doslova. A tak i Brunová tušená, nebo mnohost tušených světů, příznačně skutečně ostrovy na mnoha místech. A neváhá užít metafor plavby. Takřka nevyhnutelně, protože jakmile začneme hovořit o plavbě, jak jinak nazvat pohybující se planety, než jako ostrovy. A poneme stranou celou šíři různě intenzivních renesančních pohledů do hlubiny vesmíru očima námořníka, neboť Tychovy možnosti ostrova přímo pronikly do jedno z nejpůvabnějších děl renesanční nebo spíše manýristické astronomie, jeho asistenta do Keplerova snu neboli měsíční astronomie. Připomeňme, že tato závěrečná Keplerova práce je jak pokusem pohlédnout na Zemi z perspektivy měsíce a prokázat tak pravdu kopernikánského modelu, tak stejně tak vychází z tradice snových cest mimo Zemi, jakýmsi výstřelem představivosti ke světům a hvězdám, kam se rozum vydával stejně odvážně, jako se této cesty zdráhal. Kepler se tak v tomto doslova vědecko-fantastickém a částečně autobiografickém románu vydává co by Durakotus na doslova snovou cestu na Lunu. Nás však především zajímá, že tento pronikavý spánek snovou cestu započne zcela v souladu s Tychovou filozofickou samotou na ostrovy. Na Islandu, kde, cituji Keplera, jsem si vyhlédl místo ke svému spánku a snění, abych napodobil filozofii tohoto literárního žánru. Vždyť i Cicero, když chtěl snít, přenesl se do Afriky. Zde odkazuje na Ciceronův slavný spis Scipionův sen, který se stal Keplerovi předlohou. A Kepler dodává, také Platón vytvořil ve stejném západním oceánu Atlantidu ostrov. Jenže Kepler zdůrazní, že tento ostrov je vzdálený. Stejně jako byl Tychův ostrov vzdálený za opohu mlhy. Nesmírně pozoruhodná je totiž i konzistentní povaha těchto ostrovů. Zatímco Island, opět cituji Keplera, znamená v naší německé řeši země ledu, pak i Keplerova vzpomínka nahven zdůrazní, že, opět cituji, onen ostrov nemá kromě asi 40 rybářů žádné obyvatele, vždyť je neúrodný, skalnatý a nevelký. Jinými slovy, je to pustina. A vlastně by nás už nemělo překvapit, že samotný měsíc je Keplerem vnímaný jako ostrov. Jak přímo praví v daném díle Démon, pomyslný Durakotův převozník, cituji, 50 000 německých mil v hlubině éteru leží ostrov Levánia. To je měsíc. A cesta k němu odtud nebo z něho na Zemi se otevírá jen velmi zřídka a když se otevře, je snadná pro mašince, avšak pro lidi, které je třeba přepravit, je neskonale obtížná a spojená s nejvyšším ohrožením života. Do této naší společnosti nepřijímáme žádné pecivály, žádné tlusťochy, žádné rozmazlené lidi, ale vybíráme ty, kteří jsou v životě uvyklí neustále harcovat na koních, nebo ty, kteří se často plavívají do Indie a jsou zvyklí živit se suchary, česnekem, sušenými rybami a nechutnými jídly. Plavívají do Indie. Jak vidno, máme tady explicitně co dočinění s plavbou. A v skutku Kepler sám v poznámce k původnímu rukopisu dodá, že usnadnění práce na příběhu, cituji, nalezl v půvabnosti velmi odvážného vyprávění, které naznačovalo něco z podstaty celého vesmíru. Jak ostatně sám Lukianos upozorňuje v úvodu. Také on vyplouvá na oceán za Herkulovy sloupy a hnán větrnými víry i s lodí do výše dostává se na měsíc. To pro mě byly první kroky cesty na měsíc, cesty, do níž jsem se později pustil. Konec citace. Zde pouze v největší stručnosti dodám, že zmínka o Herkulových sloupech je skutečně explicitní a vědomou aluzí na Dantova Odysea, který se vydává za Herkulovy sloupy jako za mes lidského světa, kterou překračuje co by tabu a za tento přečin je následně svržen do pekelných žlabů. Tento Odysseus za sebou nechává Penelope, nechává za sebou domov, de facto se jako pionýr vůbec nechce vrátit. A aluze právě na to Odysea se během novověku vynoří v nesčetných variacích. Mě zde ale zajímá úplně jiný detail. A tím je povaha ostrovních pustin, na jejich březích právě přistávají astronautiční Odysseové. Vraťme se ale ke Keplerovi a jeho další poznámce, totiž, že opět cituji, když i Plutarchos vedle pohanského náboženského přesvědčení umístil očisté duší na měsíc, rozhodl jsem se podniknout zamýšlenou cestu na měsíc nejlépe z Islandu. Významnější doporučení tohoto ostrova vyplynulo z vyprávění Tychona Brahe. Bez významu nebyla ani vzpomínka na černou příběhu o Holanďanech, kteří přezimovali na zledovatelém ostrově Nová země. Kepler tímto naráží na vzpomínky Gerrita da Vera, který se sám účastnil polárních výprav Viléma Barentse v letech 1594 až 1596. A dodejme, že to není zdaleka jediný odkaz na tento spis v celém Keplerově díle. A dostáváme se zde nicméně k myšlence či riziku, které do astronomie proniká sílí bezprostředně s tím, jak se astronomie proměňuje v astronautiku. Neboť, velice, velice, velice stručně řečeno, jakmile jsou nebesa vodstvem, skrze nějž plují ostrovy, mohou se stát vodstvem, na které můžeme vyplout. A jakmile se na taková vodstva vyplujeme, můžeme přistát stejně jako ztroskota. Ta skutečně zajímavá otázka však zní, jak co by tuláci, zvědavci nebo námořníci poznáme, jaký je v tom vlastně rozdíl. A zvláště pokud na nás čekají mrazivé pouště měsíce nebo Marsu. A dovolte mi ocitovat z daného spisu několik ilustrativních pasáží. Na Nova Zembla nic neroste. Žádné listy či tráva, ani na ní nežijí živočichové, kteří se jimi živí. Nová Zembla je dokonalou pustinou, která se přebývající posádce navíc stala málem osudnou a Ver v nesmírně poutavé pasáži popisuje úzkost, že by se tato země mohla stát jejich domovem, ovšem domovem hrobem, doslova domovem věčného spočinutí. Přistání na Nové Zemi, její velkolepý objev a kolonizace, která v posledku nemá na čem se zachytit, nic tam neroste. Vůbec. Se tak skutečně fakticky vůbec neliší od ztroskotání. A zdaleka se nebude jednat o podobné dilema rozčarovaných a zmatených moře, o jediné dilema rozčarovaných mořeplavců. Mnohem později bude ku příkladu významný arktický průzkumník Israel Hayes vzpomínat na ztroskotání na březích Grónska se slovy, které vyjadřují hrůzu stejně jako nadšení a která zde pro jejich politické kvality přečtu v originále. Oh, what a sight it was, that desert waste, its cold, hard surface, glittering with a borrowed splendor, and taking to itself the robes of heaven, as if to cheat the memory of its right to halt it as the very type of what might even bear the name of desolate. Pakliže se Kepler inspiroval námořnickým spisem o ledových pláních, tato inspirace a odpovídající ambivalence přistání ztroskotání se z astronautiky vůbec neztratila. Ba naopak. A i dnes tak směřujeme především k ostrovům, k novým pevninám, obklopeným vákuem na samotné tepelné hranici absolutní nuly. A v až přízračné shodě Keplerova snu s jeho budoucím naplněním, tak astronaut Jerry Leininger hovoří v dopisech psaných z mezinárodní vesmírné stanice Mir o prožívaných podobnostech s pocity, obtížemi a vůbec životem antarktických polárníků. Stejně jako druhý muž na měsíci Buzz Aldrin, alespoň co do pořadí šlápot, na panickou zkušenost měsíce vzpomíná slovy o bezbarvé poušti či ambivalentním zvoláním Magnificent Desolation. Vraťme se ale naposledy ke Keplerovi Durakotovi, který cestuje z jednoho ostrova na jiný. Kepler mimochodem v dalších spisech mnohokrát označí Zem jako jakýsi plovoucí domov. Étos Odyssea, vydávající se přes Herkulovy sloupy do Nenávratna, sobě totiž ambivalenci ztroskotání, přistání nese jako bytostný rozměr. Stejně jako je v tomhle ohledu principiální cestou z jednoho ostrova na druhý. Z jedné samoty do druhé. Tady se vlastně takřka nemůžu vyhnout shrnutí nebo spíš parafrázy vynikajícího postřehu Žela Deleuze, jakkoliv nakládání s tímhle autorem je samo o sobě rizikem, totiž je stejný elán, který z nás z domovů, z našich ostrovů žene do dály, do vyhnanství nebo do odloučení, nás nechává přistát na ostrovech, které tento pohyb zakládá jako ostrovní pouště. Ostrovy, na kterých Odysseové přistávají, jsou vždycky pustinou, neboť Odysseové zpřetrhali vazby se světem, ze kterého vypluli. A zároveň jsou novým, radikálním počátkem světa nového. A hovoří-li Deleuze v tomto smyslu o radikálním odloučení, pak jedním dechem dodává. To je snad možné pouze tehdy, pakliže na těchto ostrovech ztroskotáme. Ale dosti toho, protože přišel čas přistoupit k samotné otázce mé odpovědi, neboť snažil jsem se téhle z té stručné črty naznačit, že cesta k poznání univerza se nesla nejen po trajektoriích imaginace, ale že v sobě zároveň nesla étos cesty, cesty k ostrovům. Ovšem pakliže astronomie sdílela s uměním elán překročení bezprostředně fyzického světa, otázka zní, zdali i umění, jakkoliv reziduálně, není vlastní stejný elán a ambivalence. A stejně takhle. Toto nemá být lichotka umění, ale v podstatě spíše vyjádření nároku. Protože stejně jako se astronomie musela v jisté chvíli otevřít umění jako artikulaci představivosti, muselo umění potvrdit nárok nebes. Nárok, že nemůže mluvit o všem, že nesmí mluvit o všem, ale musí se skutečně skromně omezit na motivy, do kterých může proniknout, které může vyjádřit. A těch mimochodem nemusí nutně být mnoho. Jednoduše, umění nemá právo, ale zároveň nemá ani sílu, prostředky na to mluvit ke všemu, na co se zaměří. Musí se omezit na motivy, které může zjevovat předtím, než se jich chopí rozum. Ale i ten druhý krok je nejenže důležitý, ale prakticky vzato důležitější, snad. Ale toto zdůrazňuje čirá analogie, otevřená otázka, otázka do pléna. Pokud dnes měli každé umělecké dílo po té, co svou normotvornou sílu ztratil styl, tak je-li každé dílo hledáním svébytného jazyka, kterým by vyjádřilo zkušenost světa, a to prostřednictvím sebe sama. A pak i pohled na každé takové dílo je vlastně pohledem do nitra, stejně jako do dály. Cestou na pustý ostrov, kterým takové dílo je a na kterém musíme začínat znovu a znovu, znovu se zorientovat, popřípadě nadhodit síť nových souřadnic. I před uměleckým dílem tak, zdá se, čelíme ambivalenci přistání a ztroskotání a nového vzchopení. A teď, jestli o cestách na pusté ostrovy neplatí na pusté ostrovy oblohy, neplatí to samé, co o zkušenosti v galerii před něčím, čemu není na první pohled rozumět, ale čemu má smysl porozumět. Pochopitelně, když to není úplný nesmysl. A co vyjádřil astronom Linenger o pobytu v prostředí kosmické lodě, která je sama dočasným plujícím ostrovem. A čili sami to, zdali to samé, co říká Linenger, se nemůže vlastně říct o zkušenosti před uměleckým dílem. Opět díky poetice cituji z originálu. Soon enough, it is difficult to determine your way back to the start. You are not in water, but on a cliff, crawling, slithering, gripping, reaching. You are not falling from the cliff. Instead, the whole cliff is falling and you are on it. You convince yourself that it is okay for the cliff and yourself on the cliff to be falling. Because when you look down, you see no bottom. You just fall and fall and fall. Děkuji za pozornost.
You can make, we will not make this kind of, as I got it, long discussion tonight, right? If you accept that, make a remark that came in my mind hearing you, and this is of course Ulysses, the last stop of Ulysses before Ithaca is the lands of the Phaiakan, Phaiaks, what do you say? I read it in German and even the old Greek sometimes, but not in not in English. And the Phaiak and and this is Nausicaa, of course, the famous figure of Nausicaa. And when I read this when I was young, I nearly was a kid, and I immediately fell in love with Nausicaa, and I said to myself, please, Ulysses, and I'm sure I'm not the only one, stay with her, you know, and don't make the final step going home to Penelope, because going back means, again, concerning our topic of economy, what I tried to say, okay, 5 euro the cigarettes, I pay 5 euro and I get cigarettes in the worth of 5 euro. That means simply Ulysses comes back after 20 years, 10 years war, 10 years on the sea in his conflict with Poseidon, and finally nothing happened, simply 20 years lost, you know. And I think a good thing would have been to stay with Nausicaa. And that was my romanticism, maybe, that told me that this idea that, because what is she standing? Nausicaa stands for generosity. Many years ago, I wrote a text about her, and 15, 16, 17, I don't know, years ago. And I remember that in the English translation, because there was a situation that so what happens? Being shipwrecked, Ulysses, naked, no boats at all. At the beginning, he has some boats, some comrades, and so on. Okay. In the end, he's totally fucked up. He's alone. He's naked, and he has nothing but himself. he's close to what George Agamben calls a kind of homo sacra. So he has nothing but his pure life, and even that is damaged. And then he wakes up naked, close to the river, and Nausicaa with her her servants is washing clothes because she has to marry soon, and with the help of Pallas Athena, the goddess, and she's there because Pallas Athena said to her, go and do that, and because she's a more or less a companion or this kind of solidarity with Ulysses. And what happens there? And this is a very beautiful scene, I would say. And then, because suddenly Ulysses wakes up, shipwrecked, damaged, naked, monstrous, totally destroyed, monstrous, naked man. So, nothing we would like to meet in different situations without any, protection. And this monster comes out of the wood and standing in front of Nausicaa, hiding a bit himself and saying, okay, and he's not saying, I am Ulysses, help me, I'm the hero of the Troy War and something like this. He's not saying this. What he says is, I need help. And then there's in the English translation of the Greek version, so all the maids, or how to say, they are fleeing, you know, they see this monstrous naked man and they're fleeing, okay, because he's a dangerous person, you don't know what's going on. And then there's this first sentence, only Nausicaa stood her ground. And when I read this, I found it so beautiful. And here, okay, again, I'm a bit romantic, but this is strong romanticism I'm defending here, not this kind of soft romanticism of the beautiful soul spoken with Hegel and so on. It's not like narcissism. It's like more to stand it. And this is generosity. And this is unconditional hospitality. To take the risk to say yes to someone you do not know. So a faceless monster, more or less. And then she says, okay, I help you. And she says, okay, you have to go to the palace of my parents. And you know that the name of the mother of Nausicaa is Arete, in old Greek, Arete, that means virtue, virtue. And later, so she shows Odysseus how to go into the palace, and you know how it works in old Greek. So then he's washed and by maids, and he gets clothes, he's shaved, maybe something like this. So he becomes a human being again. So the monster turns into a human being. And then he's already in the palace. So he's inside. So what does she did? Nausicaa, she said yes to a monster. Okay, just because I'm still thinking about our ideas of refugee crisis and so on, I'm not here making any proposals. I just want to remember for myself and for you that this idea of ideas exist, of unconditional hospitality, not knowing who the other is, because the other remains the other. And then Nausicaa stands for this kind of crazy and non-responsible, non-reasonable, his hospitality, saying, yes, okay, I tell you how you can enter the palace. And then much, much later, when she's in, and a singer is singing about the heroes concerning the war of Troy, or they say a Troy war, I don't know, then suddenly Odysseus starts crying, saying, and giving, I don't know, the information that he is the one the singer is singing about, you know. So the monster turned into the hero, but he was in course of an act of hyperbolic hospitality, hyperbolic generosity, connected to the name of Nausicaa. It was first accepted like he is, then washed. They gave him clothes, and they helped him just to become a normal human being. And then they asked him for the passport, you know. And we are used to deal otherwise with these things, with good reasons, of course. But sometimes it's good to interrogate the good reasons too. And that can be philosophy too, or the generous act of thinking. Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know how much time do we have, but I since I note some questions, technically I can have only one additional question to you, because you spoke of a life as a gift, and yet I know from the text which is published in the monograph White Rabbit that there's almost a chapter dedicated to the fact that it's almost hard to be an atheist, sorry for the pronunciation, non-believer, and that it seemed to me that your vision of philosophizing the world technically needs to get rid of any conception of God or something or similar conceptions. But I have to ask then, if you think that the very concept of generosity is maintainable without forgiving, which technically seems to me that implies somebody that forgives me, or whatever that is, just some entity, transcendental, that is giving me the forgiveness. So that was that I wanted to ask, whether the generosity as a concept doesn't imply at least a quasi-religious transcendence, forgiveness.
Yeah. Okay, this is of course a huge question, and I'm not you know, the time to reply properly. I just would like to say maybe that generosity, to put it a bit bluntly, a bit ordinary, in a kind of ordinary way, to give a kind of ordinary example. So, because it's not something we're all dealing with, these questions of generosity in everyday life, like let's say in a relationship, in friendship. You spoke about friendship, also, but in love and so on. And I would say, how do you say in English, being offended, so beleidigt sein, I say in German, so is not a solution, I would say. So this is generosity for me, simply not going into the position of the offended one. So and this is why I do not need excuses of other people. Generosity means not to demand this in a way. So I don't like it. This is more a personal remark, but of course it's close to what I think in general. But I think it's not very intelligent. In a relationship, in a friendship, there's injustice. There's behavior we do not like, we do not easily deal with, and so on. And then there's maybe, and this has nothing to do with religion or religious behavior or theology in general, for me, even not with Christianity and so on, but simply with much more with sovereignty. So if someone is offending you, give yourself time not to beat back, and not to beat back means not to have the courage to beat back, but to have the courage not to beat back for a moment. So, to make a step out of this narcissism. So this is why I spoke about narcissism tonight a bit of this evening. So because narcissism is infantilism, and infantilism is narcissism. So young kids. And we will not, we accept this at the age of 5, 6, 7. They want everything here and now, immediately. So they do not accept that you don't get everything, you neither get everything and not immediately. So imagine the situation in the supermarket with a kid and so chocolate and ice cream. And this is an example I give sometimes. And the kid says, I want ice cream and chocolate. Then, or candies or whatever, doesn't matter. And so if you're parents, I think it's a good idea not to say, yes, you get everything because I love you. So maybe you say, choose, or this or this, or today nothing of this, but maybe tomorrow. And here I would just make a remark on deconstruction. Jacques Derrida, this philosopher of deconstruction, what he called différence, written with an A, is precisely this. You don't get it immediately. So it is, that does not mean that you never get what you want. But there's time or space in between your desire and the fulfilling of the desire. And this is called reality. And just deal with it. Maybe you get it. It's even not sure, but not now. But for sure not now, but maybe tomorrow, and not the whole thing. And this is, I would say, for me, a kind of good way to deal with reality. And if I would have kids, I don't have actually, but if I would have, I would tell them, I would try to teach them this, that yes, you get my love, and my love is unconditional for you. You don't have to give anything. You know, some of you read, of course, Sartre, Les Mots, this autobiography of the young, concerning the first years, 5-6 years of the young Sartre. It's totally like in his narcissism and so on. It makes part of this literature of confession, long French tradition, and Rousseau, of course, also Swiss, and Confession, and Augustinus, if you want to go back to the 4th century. But the idea of self-accusation. And Sartre is accusing himself for being this kind of narcissistic asshole, like playing with the parents and giving them what he, of course, intelligent, how he was as a 4, 3, 4, 5 year old kid, but he knew already what they want him to give him, her, them. Very funny book, I think, a good book to read for the people that didn't read it until now, Les Mots, the Words of Sartre, because it's precisely dealing with this kind of infantilism, narcissism of someone who is not ready to deal with reality like this, and reality is not there. This is why I spoke about the moon. The moon gives a shit. He does not care about us. And that's very healthy to know. And so nice to know that most of the people do not care about what I'm writing, what I'm publishing. So me as a writer, I'm publishing, that's part of my work. I'm doing lectures and so on. And of course, I'm happy if someone is interested in what I do. I admit it immediately. But I know also that most of the people are not interested with good reasons. And that's very healthy for me to know that, and to try to accept it, that the moon does not care.
I think it would be generous to let the last question unanswered, because I don't want to ruin such a beautiful ending. Really, it's brilliant.
Join us on Friday, 7 o'clock, grand opening. year of 220th anniversary of the National Gallery.